Good evening, everyone. Thank you again so much for being with us tonight. I'm very thrilled with our guests tonight. We're going to learn so much that you need to know. And this is Fireside Chats. And so why Fireside Chats? Well, Fireside Chats were a series of radio addresses delivered by U.S. President Franklin Delano Roosevelt from 33 to 1944. They were meant at first for political purposes, and then later on became more for informational and to be inspirational for Americans who had gone through the Great Depression and then World War II. Well, our Fireside Chats are also meant to inspire and to encourage all of us to work every day to better the health of all of our patients, all of our people we deal with. We have a series where every month, sometimes twice a month, we will ask those who are at the forefront, those who have met a lot of challenges, to come up and tell us about what they have developed, their source of courage, and to discuss the newest advancements in their field of endeavor. And so tonight's guest is Dr. Todd Eldridge on myths regarding cardiovascular disease. But before I introduce Dr. Eldridge, I am moving and I'm in the process again. This is the fourth time in 8 months of moving, and I'm taking a new position as Associate Dean of Academic Affairs at Lincoln Memorial University in Knoxville, Tennessee. So the next time we have Fireside Chats, I'll be actually doing it from Tennessee. I'll be speaking a little slower, a little bit of a twang, okay? So I have to practice this just so you understand that I'm doing a lot going on right now. But here, let's talk about Todd Eldridge. Todd Eldridge is one of the world's leading experts on atherosclerosis and heart disease. He's the author of 2 number one international best-selling books, Cardiovascular Wellness Management Success Plan and Prevention Myths, Why Stress Tests Can't Predict a Heart Attack, and Which Tests Actually Do. These books have helped physicians and patients all over the world improve the tools they use to uncover hidden atherosclerotic disease, the leading cause of heart attack and strokes, and currently responsible for 1 out of 3 of the deaths in the United States. Todd Eldridge, who has his PhD in cardiovascular epidemiology, is the CEO of Cardio Risk Laboratories, and he will be speaking about cardiovascular disease prevention myths, atherosclerosis, cardiovascular methods to assess, detect, and prevent disease. These tools have been used by dentists worldwide as a value-added service to their patients, especially those at risk for cardiovascular disease and those patients who periodontal disease at any stage as part of their whole health approach. Dr. Eldridge is a frequent guest at the John Coy's Wellness Week courses in Seattle and is a speaker at the Hinman Meeting in Atlanta, Georgia. And I'd like to point out that Dr. Eldridge has been a speaker at our Golden Spike meeting in Utah. He gave a phenomenal presentation at our Salt Lake City meeting. And I really thank you again for doing that, sir. And so tell us a little bit about yourself. And what got you involved in getting a PhD in cardiovascular epidemiology?
Yeah, that's a great question, Mark. You had asked me earlier, you know, what makes me get up in the morning, and those two stories ironically are related. When I was 15, I had an older brother killed in a car accident. And that has informed my life. The value that I place on life was instilled in me at an early age through an uncomfortable and not so nice experience. But that probably was the first thing that directed me into the path of studying health and wellness. My first career was as an epidemiologist. I ran Sanofi Pasteur, the largest pediatric vaccine company in the world. I ran the pediatric business unit. And after 10 years of doing that, you know, it just wasn't fulfilling. You know, the my crowning achievement there was to change U.S. healthcare policy from oral polio to injectable polio on the basis of saving eight lives a year. And I couldn't tell you who the eight lives were, just biostatistically, we were going to save eight lives. And I woke up after winning that battle, think, you know, the celebrations and everything, and the thinking, what am I, you know, what am I doing with my life? to say, and not that the eight lives are unimportant, but I really had a desire to affect more lives. And uh-huh. So I began attending medical conferences, as you do, and ran into the man who became my mentor. It took me many years, by the way, to convince him to take an older adult student under his wing, Dr. Gene Bond. Dr. Bond's curriculum vitae is a book. You've seen the Baldonin book. His curriculum vitae is that thick. Mm-hmm. And I had to read every study. I mean, he was ruthless as an instructor, and I very much appreciate that to this day. But that, when I heard him speak, it was like an electric shock went through me. He talked about atherosclerosis. He talked about tools to identify. And it literally, I knew that was my calling. I never looked back. We made significant financial sacrifices to quit a very lucrative career with Sanofi Pasteur and kind of wing it for the few, you know, you have to make a living. I have five kids, for heaven's sake, so I couldn't just quit life. But we, you know, we juggled balls. I was with Gene for 9 years. And mm-hmm. It was really, to this day, a highlight of my life, even though I was always kind of an imbecile. You know how professors are with their students. You know, I think he always saw me under suspicion because I had this entrepreneur bug. But to date, it was one of the great privileges of my life to study with him. And I've never looked back. So 30 years I've been doing this, and I love every day. I wake up every day excited. Look, we're not going to prevent people from crossing the Rainbow Bridge. You've read the book.
Right.
Everybody's going to go. But if we can just delay it 10 more years, and I got one more story for you, Mark. Not to
delay. Oh, no, great. I love it. But yeah.
One of my passions privately is I'm a private pilot. And two mm-hmm. years ago, we had an engine fire. The only engine that I have in my single plane. We were on our way to Jackson Hole to meet some friends, and the plane caught on fire, and we had to crash land in a field. We're very, very lucky to be alive. We both broke our backs, but I can tell you that was a stiff reminder of the value of life, how important it is every day, what a gift it is. Every morning I wake up and say, thank you, Lord, for this day, and please may I have another. And that informs my life and the passion with which I go after, you know, it's definition of an expert is, you know, a lot about one thing and not much about anything else. And that fits for me. I have a passion for this one disease, and I don't really worry too much if it's outside of that lane. There are other people, thank goodness, that are studying the other things, but this is my passion. I love studying this, learn everything I can about this disease because I believe it's preventable. It's certainly treatable. And I'm passionate about empowering providers with the tools necessary to preserve and enhance human life. So,
well, I so appreciate all that. We're getting a little echo, I think, from your speakers. There you go. Thank you. I do appreciate all that because the fact, you know, I have five kids too, and yeah. I just started over a whole new career in academia again.
Congratulations on that, by the
way. Oh, yeah, thank you. And last night at our Chicago Academy Dental Research meeting, I was telling people, and one who was a student of mine at Northwestern back in the late 70s, early 80s, said to me, he says, I can tell how excited you are to be lecturing to those students at the school. I guess I really am. I'm excited to do it. I want to give another 10, 15 years to help educate the young people. And this is why we're doing the Fireside Chats, right? We're here to tell people a lot. So tell me about cardio risk. How'd you get more involved with dentistry?
Well, it really, first of all, dentistry is in our blood. I should say I tried to stay out of dentistry because my wife's family is ensconced in dentistry. I won't pass their names just because on the outside chance there's competitors. I don't want that to dirty the laundry, so to speak. But yeah, I've grown. I mean, I've been married 40 years now, and my wife's family, not her entire family, but a significant piece of them are people that most people in dentistry have heard about, names that you would know. And I know you know mm-hmm. who I'm talking about, Mark. But and so I made a deliberate effort to stay out of dentistry because I didn't want to, you know, that was kind of their box to stand on. But in a stroke of irony, I work with Drs. Brad Bale and Dr. Amy Donin, and they published a study that fascinated me about 5 years ago with the Johns Hopkins, that found two bacteria in the mouth that were not associated but causative of cardiovascular disease. And so I opened the kimono pretty wide on that research to say, is that possible? And of course, it's painfully obvious that as soon as you dig in, you're like, of course, you know, like, look, if you got a bleeding gum, those pathogens go directly into the circulatory. They do not pass go. They don't have to stop at the gut and get dissected by all of the gut biomes. Like, they go directly into the circulatory. So it was kind of like getting hit in the head with a sledgehammer and like, well, duh. And so, you know, that, and then I got, it seems like I was introduced a short time after that to AOSH, or it was founded shortly after that. And it seemed like it was all a marriage there. So obviously, we're supportive of the goal of the whole reason CardioRisk exists is to give providers time to treat this disease medically, so that the only choice left to a patient is not just a surgical intervention. Time is the goal here, is to give people more time to treat it medically, not surgically.
Why don't you tell us a little bit more about what CardioRisk does? What is a CIMT, and a little bit of the information behind it?
So in 1986, a researcher, a cardiologist actually in Italy by the name of Pignoli, discovered that ultrasound, which had already been a new and emerging technology, could be used to identify atherosclerotic lesions in the carotid arteries. And that was about the extent of his research. He really didn't do anything else in the field that I'm aware of. But that launched a cascade of researchers saying, really, we can do this? So through the 90s, the late 80s and the 90s, the time that I was working in fellowship, for at least part of that time, there was just this plethora of research going on. Dan O'Leary, Joe Pollack, Eric DeGroot, Damiano Baldessari, Osama Honda, just really great researchers just pounding away at this, using this technology. In fact, you may be surprised to learn, most people are, I'm not aware of a single drug on the market for cardiovascular disease that doesn't have a CIMT study on file. Mm-hmm. Because the FDA, clear back in the 90s, accepted IMT as a surrogate endpoint for disease. So in other words, instead of counting dead bodies or counting mortality or events even, they were allowed to use IMT because it was so predictive of future events. In a stroke of irony, subsequent to that time, people are second guessing that, and it kind of makes me laugh, to be honest, if it weren't so serious, because the data has been out for years. And mm-hmm. like I said, it biggest case in point, if you look at the Crestor package insert, right in their package insert, it's got CIMT data in there. And so the challenge with this technology was something that was a match made in heaven for my skills. One of the things I did at Sanofi Pasteur was get involved. And one of the ways I paid through my fellowship was a consulting business where I did quality analysis using biostatistics. And so the number one problem with this technology is reproducibility. So you have this great, if you look at aggregates, you get great data, but as soon as you got to an N of one, you had all kinds of problems that things fell apart. And so back late 1990s, I got involved with, as a consultant to a company that built the first edge detection software, which enabled us to to look on a, on an image and determine the edges of these interfaces, the Lumen Intima interface and the Media Adventitia border. And so we got that through the FDA, got their clearance on that. And that got me interested in this specific technology. And again, in the early 2000s, then the research was coming out and I was working with Gene. They had a problem with reproducibility and that was right up my alley. So all I did is take Gene's protocol that was used in the atherosclerosis results of community study, the class that like virtually every landmark study used his protocol. I just took that protocol and used biostatistics to perfect it to where we could get the standard deviations, the coefficients of variability down to an area that would make it useful in an N of one. And we can talk more about that. That might be more information you guys want to know, but
it's very, very important.
It's important research. So,
But I always like to tell people, I talk about this all the time. I know I mentioned to you, I was lecturing in Clearwater, Florida over the weekend. Yeah. I asked a group of dentists, a lot of them were in their 40s and 50s and 60s. My people here have had a CIMT done, not one hadn't raised it, and they don't even know what it is. So I would always have to explain, well, it's an ultrasound of the carotid. Do you look at the common carotid, the bifurcation, the external carotid? Do you look at the area right there? And do you look at the thickness of the walls, the intima, the inner wall, the media, the middle part of the wall, and so on? And you look for hard plaque and soft plaque. And I just do that simple explanation because I'm not an expert like you are. But we have to get this message out.
Yeah. Well, first of all, that is a really, and I neglected in all of that gibberish, I neglected to give you a definition. That is the definition. And let me just equate it to something that dentists are familiar with. Perio pockets, right? If you took the average perio pocket, if you're looking for pockets in a patient, there is tremendous variability. This is studied. Mm-hmm. This is in research. Tremendous variability from one provider, never mind patient to patient, but from one provider to the next, measuring the exact same patient, there's tremendous variability, which diminishes the useful. We still use it, right? We use it every day because we don't have something better. But I would equate IMT has the same problem, that where you start the measurement matters. What is the distal 1 centimeter? And 100 other questions I could throw out that if not adequately addressed, just like in looking at the pocket depth of a periodontal disease patient, unless you define those parameters really clearly, and even then there's going to be coefficients of variability. But it's a very similar, like you can see it in your mind. The tolerances on perio pockets are in the millimeters, right? Mm-hmm. Like I'm measuring in millimeters, same with IMT. In fact, the coefficients of variability, the standard deviation, which we'll get to later, I know, is 0.02 millimeters. You would be hard-pressed to find any test in any genre of medicine, dentistry or medicine, that has anywhere near that type of a coefficient of variability. And it has to be. It's necessarily so, which we'll talk about more, I know, later. But anyway, hopefully that, when we talk about perio pockets, people get that in dentistry and you can see it and you know that you're measuring slightly different, and you don't have to measure much different to get a very different number between providers when you're measuring those periodontal pockets.
And the important thing about having it be reliable is the data. Like one of the things you talk about is that 10-year, 100,000 patients per year longitudinal study that showing that you can use IMT technology to catch for 98.6% of heart attacks and strokes before they occur. This is so vitally important.
Maybe we can talk about that for a second, Mark. You
yeah,
love that you're bringing up, that you're getting right to the essence of these discussions. So that study was so unique for so many reasons. So first of all, they took a unique cohort, a population of asymptomatic, they had no signs or symptoms of disease. They had none of the traditional risk factors but one. And I'm just jaundiced enough to believe that they left one in there so they could have some disease. They left smokers in there. But
oh, now, good, good.
But by the time, by the time of the study, I can tell you that that was not, at least in Europe where they did this, was not the risk factor for the disease. So not one of these people in the study qualified for a pharmaceutical intervention, not one. In fact, if they had inflated blood pressure, if they had high cholesterol, low HDL cholesterol, if they had any traditional risk factors, they were out of the study. And here's why. They had all of these people sign a waiver that says, we agree to not be treated for the 10-year window.
Oh, yes.
It would be preposterous. We'd never get an IRB on that, right? But we didn't know at the time that IMT was going to be so predictive. So then they start the study, this asymptomatic, low-risk population. And lo and behold, one after another, infarcts, strokes. They had all of these events. Well, when they went and looked at the data, had four categories of people. The, you know, the largest 79% ish were completely normal, but IMT, this technology we're talking about, caught over 98% of the events before they occurred. That's unprecedented in all of medicine. You even a home pregnancy test is 97%. So if you think about adding a tool to your toolbox that has the potential to catch over 98%. Of the heart attacks and strokes before they occur, that is a pregnancy of heart disease. And that's why, you know, so we can talk later why dentistry, but that's the significance of this study, is that we now know if you find disease, an atherosclerotic plaque of any size, absent an intervention, they have a 40% 10-year risk rate. Well, that is more telling than Framingham, Reynolds, all of the traditional risk. There's not a risk tool assessment tool out there that gives you that high of a risk ratio. So
I think that's important for you to talk about, because that's one of the things you lecture on. You do compare it to the Framingham study and others, where, but when you go see your internal medicine specialist for your annual checkup, or in my case, every 3 years, if I need it or not, they always talk about Framingham. They always talk about, you know, they look at your cholesterol levels and they go, oh, your cholesterol is too high. Your LDLs are too high. Your HDL, the LDL ratio is off. You need to be on this statin. And they never say, do a CIMT. What can we do to change that?
Well, there's a couple of things, thoughts that I have on that. The first is that amongst medical providers, there is not a clear understanding that all of the risk factors associated with the Reynolds risk score, the Framingham risk score, every single one of them is a risk factor associated with your risk of disease, risk of acquiring the disease that causes heart attacks and strokes. IMT is a measure of disease.
Mm-hmm.
And so that's the first separation we need to make. We're not measuring your risk of disease. It's a measure of disease and telling you risk of events. And it's a very different mind thought that is, and one of the challenges with the technology is in medicine, we always talk risk factors, meaning risk factors of disease. And it's a little bit of a mind melt to wrap our head around, oh yeah, we're talking about risk of events. This is a measure of disease. It's a very, yeah. It's a subtle, but very important. So then why has it not become standard of care? That's a great question. And I want to be really honest about the technology. It has weaknesses. One of the weaknesses is the reproducibility issue and the fact that there's not a standardized protocol. Let me tell you why that makes a difference. There have been 100 or so meta-analyses where they took multiple labs using different protocols. They, you know how meta-analysis is. Mm-hmm. We put them all in a pot and we say what spits out. Well,
if they're all different.
Three of those meta-analysis, when they spit out, what they spit out is, well, IMT doesn't work. Well, you have to understand the data. So one analogy, if I could use, you can imagine if we did a study and we measured air travel from Los Angeles to New York. Okay. Just imagine we're going to take 2,500 planes and we're going to measure efficacy of those of air travel to New York. and we stop the study in 3 hours, what's going to happen? We could conclude with 100% confidence interval, right? 99.97% confidence interval that air travel was not efficacious to getting you to New York City. Not because air travel isn't efficacious, but because we only did a 3-hour study. It's a 4.5-hour flight to New York, right? Right. So we have to be really careful when we look at meta-analysis, what we're looking at. So the meta-analysis regarding IMT was flawed in several ways. One, the number of heart attacks in the time window was very flawed. But second, when you take everybody's using a different protocol. Everybody's defining the distal 1 centimeter even, which sounds pretty straightforward. Nope, that's not even. Let me give you one example. We went to a group. I lectured at a group. I'm not going to remember the SAIP, Society of Atherosclerosis Image. Anyway, they had a luminary, a very famous cardiologist by the name of. I'm going to have a senior moment. Who did all of the niacin studies? Alan Taylor, yeah, great guy, brilliant cardiologist out of Walter Reed, and a luminary. So he holds this 2-day training seminar. Now he had all of these physicians who were interested in the technology. Put them all in a room. They had the same computer, so no variability, same monitor, same software, right? So he's cutting out all the variabilities, which is what you do as a scientist. They had the same set of images, meaning all 100, it was not quite 100, but let's about 100 providers. These are physicians, medical doctors, looking at the same set of images, and he had them read them using the edge detection software we had created, right? Guess what the smallest variability was between any two people in the room? So I'm talking about the smallest. So you can picture dots under the rock curve, right? So receiver operator curve. So we've got people way out here, but the closest that any two got was 0.1 millimeter. That is five times the standard deviation we allow in our measurements, because you can't even, with that much variability, you can't even tell who's sick and who's not sick. And that's what I'm emphasizing, is these studies with different protocols, you just can't hope to have any congruent data out of there, because they're all measuring it different. And where you take the measurement in exact terms, what is the exact starting spot anatomically of the bifurcation, for example, where do we define, what is the exact spot of that distal 1 centimeter? If we don't define that clearly, we have no chance of minimizing the variability.
Well, you bring up a great point with meta-analysis, because that's been a pet peeve in research for a long time, as people put together studies that were done completely differently by different institutions and the variability ruins any type of potential knowledge you can get out of it that you can.
I'm a big fan of meta-analysis, but they have to be. But when you do meta-analysis, you have to understand what are you looking at, and be very focused on that. When you try to get data that's not, you know, that's you just have to be very careful with it. I'm a huge fan of meta-analysis if it's done right.
Right, of course. Now let's go back to what we can do for our patients with this. And this is really important for the clinicians to realize that it is a very good reproducible test. How can we get this into the hands of dentists? We have talked before about DSOs, large perio practices. How would you, if you're in dental practice, how would you approach this? It's find someone you can work with, find a physician you can work with. What's been the reality? What's going on the ground?
If I can be, I want to be real careful. I know this is a CE course and I don't want to mention the company name, but those are the stories I know. So I hope you'll solve me a little, give me a little attitude there. But the first thing you have to understand is if you have a patient in dentistry that has periodontal disease, it's a no-brainer. Right. I will tell you, it's a 1-to-1 ratio. I will guarantee you they have disease. It may not be an atherosclerotic plaque, but they will at least have inflammation in the wall of their artery, I would guarantee. Or they're well along the path. If they have bleeding gums, even now, some bleeding gums you can arbitrarily, you know what I'm talking about. You can arbitrarily kind of instigate bleeding gums, but I'm talking about normal bleeding. I do a little floss, and my gums are bleeding. That is a direct pathway of those pathogens to get in there. So that would be the second list. If they have dry sockets, if they have dry mouth, so think about all of the conditions that dentistry treats. Those are red flags that would say, hey, I wonder, hopefully the provider would say, I wonder what else is going on beneath the surface, what's going on arterially. And so we don't need them to treat the disease except as it exists in the mouth. That's
right.
That's what we hope, that they're treating periodontal disease and all of the diseases of the mouth. And the disease, and then we hope that they're working with a primary care physician to work on the inside. So if they need a statin, if they need medical treatment, then we hope that they'll partner with a physician who knows this disease and can treat it. Now, in terms of how do they identify it? Look, if they fall into any of those categories, periodontal disease, dry sockets, dry mouth, bleeding gums, especially periodontal and bleeding gums, we would put them in the category they need an IMT. Why? Because it's going to catch over 98% of the events. Now, in terms of how they implement, I wouldn't presume to tell them how to run their practice, but we do have dental offices doing it the way that it works with our company, and there are lots of models. So our standard deviation in peer-reviewed published data is 0.02 millimeters. So you can bank on, you can track it year over year and see if they're getting better or worse, right? The second thing is our requirement is just 15 patients. So, you know, think about it. I would challenge a provider to say in an average month, tell me you don't see 15 patients. Your hygienist doesn't see 15 patients that meets that criteria. Even right out of school that doesn't have that.
Yeah. It's like you have these big perio practices where, you know, almost every patient.
Yes.
Should have IMT done.
Every one of them. And the economics.
Right.
Can we talk economics for a second? Again, I'm going to broad stroke it because I don't want to presume again to tell a dentist how to do anything. But the average national price is about $249 for this test. And it's a cash price. We can talk about that in insurance later. Our charge, just as an example, for a reference point, is about, I think it's about $119. So there's $130 of play in there for the provider if they charge the full retail. Why is that? Well, they have to pay for their overhead, their office space. But 15 patients, let me put an exclamation point, that's less than a half a day work. That's 3 hours work. So dentists are experts, their staff, at scheduling people for the next appointment. You know, before I walk out of the door of my dentist's office, he's got me booking my next appointment. They know how to do this better than any medical office I've ever seen. And so it's just as simple as saying, the dentist saying, hey, you've got pockets. I am worried about your heart disease. I want you to make an appointment. And then their appointment desk would have the next 12 dates of when we're coming in to do scans. And we need, all we need is a dental chair or some kind of bed where they can lay down in a supine position. They don't have to be completely supine, but we want to lay them back. And we need it. It's four patients an hour. So they're not waiting around in the waiting room. They just come in, they check in, and our guys run right on time. Every 15 minutes, like clockwork, they're another patient's out and a new one's in. That 15 minutes includes time to go get the patient. So it's an easy business model. It doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure out how to implement if you have the space. Now, if you don't have the chairs, I'm not sure how we, you know, we'd have to get creative.
Well, I always think that this is something that's a great benefit to the patients because they're not hearing about it. And I'm assuming that it's not covered by Medicare. I'm making an assumption there.
It is, but let's put brackets around that if we can.
Okay, let's put that in a back burner anyway.
Well, there is a CPT code that is covered, but who's it covered for? Medicare, Medicaid, and all of the insurance companies do not cover preventative tests as a rule. The exception are, you know, your colonoscopy and your breast exam, but they don't cover them. So what they'll cover it for is once we have a diagnosis, ironically. So once we know you have disease, they cover it very well, but they don't tend to cover it as a screen, which is when they need it.
So, yeah, that's the same thing with continuous glucose monitors. It's best to have a CGM on before you're a diabetic, not after you're a diabetic. I mean, what is wrong with these people? But I mean, well, we know what's wrong with them.
Well, it's because we have a sick care system. It's not a health care system.
Going back to like big DSOs and stuff like this, I'm really kind of pushing this because I feel that it's the same thing as doing an HA1C on your patients. The same thing as doing blood pressure. I mean, you measure a person's blood pressure. You can tell when they come in if they're overweight. You can ask them if they exercise. You can ask them about their diet. If they have all these things, yeah, burger and fries for lunch today, you're about 60 pounds overweight, your blood pressure is 170 over 100. You're looking at this person and they have severe perio. Then you say, when's the last time you saw your physician? 3 years ago. Okay. I mean, we've got to intervene and not just think in terms of how can we expect medicine to think that dentistry should be included in healthcare if don't think in the same terminology that we need to be working with them and then refer them and find out who their physician is and say, hey, let's do the IMT. We'll have them get the results. And hey, maybe you do need to do some, and of course, cleaning up the perios, number one. You were going to say something. I didn't mean to interrupt you.
No, I interrupted you and I apologize. I got excited because first of all, that's what AOSH is all about, right?
Right.
So I just wanted to plug AOSH for a second. But second, look, the number one resistance I get from dentists, Mark, and you'll appreciate that. And I've got a son that's a dentist. I got another one that just started dental school this year. I'm savvy. I understand the reticence you may have. Aren't I crossing the line into medicine? But look, we are not ever going to ask a dentist to treat this. We're simply saying, look, if you are concerned, if you buy into the AOSH stated objectives and you're looking at whole health, then you have to acknowledge to your patients for their sake, hey, I see red flags. And anybody check your risk of heart disease? Once a month, we have this guy come in and do these tests. It's the pregnancy test of heart disease. It's only, $249 or whatever they want to charge. But it's a small effort. It makes a huge difference because if there's red flags on that report, they need a primary care physician. And on average, Mark, they're going to see the dentist five times as often as they will see their primary care doctor. Right. If I sound desperate, it's because I see how critical the dentist is in this whole health gambit that we're trying to do. If the dentist doesn't get involved, God help us.
Oh, I agree.
We're not going to get there.
We have a question. We're going to get that question later, Janet. She has a question. What is done for patients who have a positive result in the test? Well, you got cardiovascular disease. but the main thing is, I even want to take it a little step further. One of the things I want to do at the College of Dental Medicine is have IMT as being part of the perio. Get perio treatment. I'd love to actually see IMT results over a period of time on perio patients. That's one of the things I want to talk to you about because I want to set that up. And we want to talk about things like other things like salivary testing, because that's really important.
Hugely important.
But for me, and I have seen the studies on this, for young people, for teens and preteens, we have kids coming in who are obese, who are pre-diabetic. And as you know, from the studies, by age 18, right? Young males by age 18, 50% of atherosclerosis.
Well, even before that, Mark, heart study, for heaven's sakes, was done in the 90s. We showed kids as young as 5 years old. Of course, they were in the gravy states, where gravy's a beverage down in the South. But we had five-year-olds with disease. We're not saying that we're going to put five and eight-year-olds on a statin. But for heaven's sakes, the more time we have with this disease, the more time we know it. The reason we're having so many heart attacks and strokes in America is not that we don't know how to treat it. We have known how to treat this disease for 50 years. There's not a doctor coming out of medical school doesn't know what to do about it. The problem is we're waiting until the cardiologist can, and it's too late.
Yeah, so it's way too late.
We're grossly, grossly underdiagnosing. And if we can get better at identifying those that have disease, we've got a fighting chance. By the way, you probably don't want to talk about epidemiology, but the statistics for epidemiology are horrific in the last
year. I know. On this you have mentioned that. You've mentioned that before in your lectures. I maybe we'll get to it later, but I want to go back to the kids again because, published in New England Journal of Medicine on the autopsy study on kids. Yeah, 5, 6, 7 years. 20-some-odd% of them had cardiovascular disease by the time they had atherosclerosis, by the time they were like 12 and so on. But, you know, the average onset of periodontal disease is actually 17, age 17.
I didn't know that.
And so we would have kids all the time coming with braces and they're gushing blood everywhere and they have severe invasion. Porphyromonas gingivalis and Fusobacterium nucleatum have just completely invaded all their tissue and they're 10 years old. They're in phase one orthodontics. And of course, you already have kids on a horrible diet or pre-diabetic. They're in a pro-inflammatory status. And when, Janet, when you were asking what you can do is when you tell someone you have atherosclerosis, when you tell someone, they don't just blow it off. It's in their mind.
Yeah.
And when you tell a parent that your child who's 10, 11, 12 has all the severe periodontal disease, which is a total body inflammatory disorder. And yeah, they do need to exercise. They do need to brush better. They do need to floss better. They do need to eat better and not snack on junk all the time. I think this is where we have to really start looking at going early on. And there's some really good published stuff. Now, I think one of the things that might be holding it back, you did mention a little bit, was maybe insurance. Is insurance an issue?
Well, actually, I think it's more, look, that my opinion on this, because we pounded the insurance. We got a house bill down in Texas where it was mandatory to cover IMT. But here's what's
wonderful.
Happening.
Wonderful.
Well, it wasn't. Here's the problem. The dentists have been very smart as it relates to insurance so far. Now, they're heading down a path. I'm not going to tell them how to run their business, but I can tell you what has happened to primary care doctors. And if you're a primary care doctor and you happen to be on this, then I have great empathy for you. But they accepted insurance. And now you've got MBAs running the program, telling them what to pick up and whatnot. And here's the net result of taking insurance for primary care. They want them to see between 30 and 50 patients a day. That's physician time. Now, I don't care how good of a doctor you are. It doesn't matter. You cannot do an hour and a half of medicine in a 5-minute visit. It cannot be done. And so what they're doing is triage, which is why we have a sick care system, not healthcare. Now, how in the world are you going to implant in a 5 or 10 minute visit an additional technology like IMT and explain it to the patient? You don't have time to talk to them about the hangnail the patient came to see about, much less get into a lengthy discussion about wellness or prevention. And so in my mind, that is the problem. The MBAs of the world have looked at actuary tables and said, primary care doesn't matter. I hate to say that to my primary care physician friends, because it does matter. But the MBAs and the actuaries in the insurance company have written off. You can talk to them. They will tell you in explicit terms, primary care doesn't matter. It's a waste of time. What we want is sick care. We just want to take care of people that are sick. That is nuts. And that's the problem, Mark, is that if we can get, so who's doing it? Concierge doctors that are spending an hour and a half or 2 hours with a patient, they are adopting this in droves. Virtually every one of them is implementing this. But in the standard managed care organization, I don't know that we're going to see it. And it's a time issue. More than it is, we don't trust the technology. At least that's what they tell me.
It's funny because they'll order an echocardiogram done.
Well, they don't do it.
I know.
They go to the cardiologist, and the cardiologist, that's what they do all day. And it'll tell you absolutely nothing about prevention. It'll just tell you if I can operate or not.
There's a screening tool, really, for doing a surgery beforehand.
It is a worthless screening.
see if you can find a surgery case to do basically what it is and all that. And of course, you started to talk about doctors and the diagnosis. And I do want us to talk a little bit about AI and the use of that with IMT.
Yeah. So AI is really fascinating. I've been involved in AI and IMT since probably late 90s. We had the first AI model that would automatically find the interface between the lumen intima and the media adventitia. And AI is very useful for identifying those interfaces. But many of your listeners may not be aware that AI hallucinates. For example, we did a study with, it was hand x-rays. So imagine this, an x-ray of my hand, and where they had done, we asked AI to say, find me where there had been segmental work on a digit. And it would go through all of the x-rays and find it. And then we asked it, well, find us an x-ray where there are segmentals on two fingers. And you know what it gave us? Six fingers. They weren't real six fingers. It artificially drew the six fingers. So AI, we have to be careful because it hallucinates. I would equate it to a child that dreams and they can't tell the dream, you know, oh, dad, there's a monster under my bed because they dreamt it. AI is in that stage. Now, if you get into quantum machine learning, there's some really cool stuff. I'm of the opinion that there will not be a drug put out in the American medical system that hasn't used quantum machine learning in the next. I think that'll happen 10 years from now. I don't think you'll have any drugs coming out that didn't go through quantum AI.
I hope they go backwards and look at some of those that just have recently approved. They have a very low efficacy rate with Alzheimer's. I mean, you talk to the neurologists and they're just almost they're livid with some of the new drugs.
I think AI has huge potential. The challenges it relates to what you asked me about on IMT, the challenges are not few. So number one is you can only analyze on the AI the images you're given. So if I don't have a good protocol in the acquisition of the image, what am I measuring? Right. So I essentially set the AI up for failure. I think AI is really useful to find the interfaces. The second is AI is not very good at determining boundaries. So if I say, what is the precise location of where the internal carotid meets the bifurcation, where the bifurcation meets where's the precise location anatomically where bifurcation ends and the common carotid begins? And AI is worthless for that, completely worthless. And part of that is because the anatomy changes. So I would say for AI to be useful in IMT, two things have to happen. The acquisition of the images has to be standardized, which right. we've done in our shop. And then second of all, you have to clearly define in logical terms that AI can understand what is the criteria you're using to establish the boundaries. And so far in all of the AI studies I've seen, they haven't done that. And then you have the third problem, which is the hallucinogenic. It just flat out makes stuff up. And that's problematic.
Well, they probably got that from the politicians, unfortunately.
Well, it's if you think about it, it's absolutely cool. Like it excites me to know that a machine can make stuff up. It's just absolutely fascinating to me. But anyway.
Hey, but we started to talk about the importance of periodontal disease, and we kind of slipped away from. We have to go back to it again because again,
I do that absolutely.
Yeah, pressure. Yeah, and there's so much work that has been done, and there's so many good, valuable salivary testing. So, I think in a way, what we're saying is that we have a protocol for prevention of not just atherosclerosis, but the same pathogens for periodontal disease are pathogens for inflammatory Alzheimer's and for insulin resistance and diabetes. And a lot of them cross over for arthritis and cancer is huge with Porphyromonas gingivalis and Fusobacterium nucleatum. And people have seen the research on cancer and the micro niches. So now you have someone at high risk for perio, atherosclerosis, everything else. You do the IMT, you show they have the atherosclerosis, you also should be doing more work to work them up for cancer, but this all revolves around having that extra little bit of a salivary diagnostics looking. Again, it's a package that what we have to do as a oral professional, I know you know this, and we're talking like buddies here, you know, commiserating on the fact we have to have this package that we have to educate every dentist and physician in, that it is one body, a set of pathogens that go everywhere and do a whole bunch of things. And they have allies and they have enemies, and there are prebiotics that help our probiotics and all that. In fact, one thing I think is really fascinating is, again, it's an animal study. It was done with mice, but they made a porphyrimulus. Yeah, the porphyrimulus gingivalis vaccine.
Very cool.
And they used, they just heat treated the, heat shocked the porphyrimulus gingivalis. I love this. And they gave it as a nasal vaccine, because nasal vaccines are extremely effective, as you know, Todd, they're very effective, to vaccinate the mice against the porphyrimulus gingivalis. And the effect on the atherosclerosis was similar. And in fact, you could not find a difference between that and a statin. Now, the funny thing about all this is, of course, the vaccine, you would do it like, maybe you have to do it once and then get boosted every 2 years, but you wouldn't be taking a pill every day and be treating the perio. I'm sitting there like, why isn't this being done on human trials?
I think that is, you're talking to a vaccine guy, right? So I think that—
Right now.
I happen to know that is being looked at. It's what they do, before they get permission, the IH gives them permission to do it, or NIH, before they get permission to do it in a large body, they do it. And I happen to know a guy that's working on that in human studies, right? They're trying to get permission for that.
Oh, I know the Keystone too, Keystone people.
Very, very cool stuff.
But yeah, I know that.
Mark, the goal is to get our listeners here, you know, how can they implement this stuff? And in my mind, I'm interested in your thoughts on this, but in my mind, every dentist is already doing checking for periodontal disease. They're checking for bleeding gums. They're checking for dry mouth, dry sockets, all of that. So that seems primary. And then everybody that's red has one of those conditions, meaning the next test is a pregnancy test for heart disease. It seems like a no-brainer. And then what do we do? Well, then, because somebody had asked, well, what happens if they have a positive result? Well, then the dentist, what do they do? They treat the stuff that they can treat. It's all here. And they send a referral out to a doctor for, hey, by the way, they've got plaque in here. And most of those patients are not being treated by a primary care doctor because their doctor doesn't have time to see them. But if you can just get one guy to say, hey, oh my gosh, this is empirical evidence of atherosclerotic disease. Hopefully that provider will say, oh yeah, no, I'm going to treat them differently than treating risk factors. And if you don't, by the way, find a different provider would be what I would say.
Oh, yes, absolutely. I think that's so important.
If they have a positive result, I would tell the dentist, please treat what you know how to treat. Treat the mouth, for heaven's sakes. That is the correct pathway. We don't know that's the only cause, but it's certainly one of them. So let's get
a very important cause.
Let's do saliva tests. Find out what the salivary tests will tell us. Which pathogen is creating a problem? And then there's all kinds of, you know, you can wax eloquent on the PerioProtect or what are we going to do to treat the biomes, but we have to treat them out. And then that doesn't keep us from sending them over to a referral over to a primary care doctor to say, hey, this guy's got plaque like 3 inches from his brain. Don't you think we got to treat that? And if the doctor says, no, I'm not too worried about it, his cholesterol is okay, I would say find a new provider. I would be that bold.
I would agree with you 100%. And that's what the whole idea about us mentioning this tonight is to get out to everyone that it's not even, you can actually have periodontal disease and not always have bleeding too on probing, which is very misleading. You have to do the salivary diagnostics. And then after you do get started treating, it's not just removing the pathogens, it's trying to get back the commensals, and the probiotics are supposed to be there, like the nitrate reducing bacteria. Get your Neisseria back. When you get rid of strep mutans, there's a little thing here, Todd, and this is microbiology. I know you're not crazy.
Well, you're also treating the gut, Mark.
Yeah, you're treating. Yeah, you're treating. Yeah, you're treating everything. And by the way, strep mutants has been linked now to oral and throat cancer strongly. But if strep mutans produces mutacin, and mutacin kills the Neisseria bacteria that are important for breaking nitrates down to nitrite to make the nitric oxide. So you have capillary dilation and you get cardiovascular healing. It's directly affecting strep mutans is directly affecting your cardiovascular function. Wait, I said directly, it's indirectly actually, because there's a
Indirect.
couple steps.
Well,
Yeah.
it
Yes, but
expands
it has an
your
effect. I mean, so if you get rid of the strep mutans, you can do that with probiotics that produce hydrogen peroxide, like strep parasanguinus, strep sanguis, strep ubera, strep borealis. And of course, the prebiotics inhibit the attachment of Porphyromonas gingivalis, just like many of the probiotics, to the cells, including the endothelial cells, epithelial cells, prevents a leaky blood-brain barrier, prevents all these issues. There's so much. And when you go to AOSH, you learn all this stuff because there's a ton of things
I
you
would
can
hope they would
do.
take what you just said in a sub tape and look, because that's the number one question I get is dentists say, well, what do I do about it? Oh my gosh, the mouth is just full of these. Like if you treat the mouth, you might very well, we don't know for sure yet, but you might very well solve the whole problem. I still believe am of a believer that
Oh
they need
yeah, you can. And if you have an oral dysbiosis, you can have a gut
Yes.
dysbiosis. And here's the crazy thing about this, and Todd knows about this too, and we're just talking about for everyone else, your gut is loaded with cholesterol degrading bacteria. There is a number of very important probiotics in your gut probiotics that produce cholesterol dehydrogenase. They'll break down that cholesterol. And we mentioned how Porphyromonas and gingivalis and Fusobacterium nucleatum get within the macrophages. When they're within the smooth muscle cells in the coronary arteries, and they actually, or actually many arteries, they actually produce cholesterol. And a lot of those fats you see in atherosclerotic plaque that is within the plaque, that's actually from the bacteria. And that beautiful study is going back 11, 12 years ago in Journal of Lipid Research. So yeah, we have to look, as a dentist, you need to look at IMT.
That's the takeaway, and I didn't want to say it that bold, but look, there is, and more importantly, Mark, don't you think, from a how do I implement in my practice, it's not all refer out to the yes, they do need if they have plaque, trust me, they need a primary care doc too. But there's so much you can do right here that it really does. If you're looking at whole health as a dentist, it's really, and that's what I love about AOSH, it's an integrated approach. And when you understand the oral systemic connection and are willing to treat the mouth biomes, you're also treating the gut, which means you're creating systemic. I don't know if we can go so far as to say it'll eliminate the disease, but it's sure going to knock off a few things off the checklist that are no
Oh,
longer
absolutely.
problematic. Yep.
Now it's all about survivability. You want to give, we got just 2 minutes left. Talk to us about survivability and cardiovascular disease. How great are we doing after we're really sick?
Yeah, look, here's if you can forgive the epidemiologist in me. In the last, since 2007, we've seen a 21% increase in global CVD disease. We've seen a 28.5% increase in the prevalence of CVD since 2007. A 9% increase in stroke risk, a 27% increase in non-coronary atherosclerosis. It just gets, it gets, it's horrific. We were a board of directors looking at these
Todd,
statistics
you're breaking
for a
up.
CEO. Oh, I'm sorry.
You are breaking up.
We
I
were
think you got so excited that you're
fine.
overwhelming your microphone. Your microphone was standing back on like, oh, please stop, man, you're killing
I do
me.
that. I'm nothing if not enthusiastic. Listen, the bottom line is the numbers are horrific. We would fire a CEO who, if they were charged with reducing events in the last 20 years, we would have to fire them because the KPIs, the key performance indexes, are horrific in the last, they've gone up. We're talking 20, 27% increases. So we have to do better. And in my mind, that means it's an all hands on deck, including dentistry. We've got to get dentists on board to do what they can do.
Oh yeah, it's going to be up to us. We are the most important healthcare providers right now, because most of our practices, not all, but most of our practices, we still have the time, especially our hygienists have the time to talk prevention. Your hygienist has the time to talk IMT and hand a brochure to somebody. You know, if they know there is a perio patient that's coming in all the time, periodontist, the patients already trust them. They've been referred to them. They have the time and they have the obligation, because they know that patient by definition needs to have it done.
So because it's CE Mark, we're not going to give a link or anything to, but hopefully somewhere in a not relative to this event, we can give them how to get IMT in their office. It's stupid easy. It's very easy to implement.
Stupid easy, yeah.
And our people are well versed in how to walk you through the mechanics. So you know, it's not going to be a very difficult ask.
Well, Todd, thank you so very, very much. This has been great. Yeah, so we always have fun though. We always have fun because you know we. And by the way, I still had about 30 questions, but we didn't have time for it. But we'll have you speak again because you're a phenomenal educator, and like I said, I really want to start doing some university studies and get everything going. So, but it's time for us to give everyone their 1 hour of. They've had their 1 hour of attention. Thank you so much, everybody. And this is at the point where, let me grab our sheet. We talk about our next people coming up because, thank you. There we go. We have Andrew Smith, who is the, I guess you would call him the president of the Association of Dental Service Organizations. He will be speaking on the changing dental landscape, innovations, integration, and practice. So you'll learn a little bit more about how to do that. And then, of course, that is on October 11th and November 15th. We have periodontal inflammation, the local systemic link demystified with Dr. Faye Goldstep. And by the way, we will be soon coming out with our journal of oral systemic health. And Todd, if you would like to write an article for that, that'd be fantastic. Our publisher is Sage. Our next meeting is the upcoming Pacific Northwest Regional, which will be at the DoubleTree by Hilton in Portland on November 2nd. Please, if you're in that area, be sure to attend. We have some phenomenal speakers. Again, Todd, I want to thank you so very much. We had a great evening. And next time I'll be doing this, I'll be speaking with slight Southern accent.
Thanks, Mark.
Thank you again, Todd. Thank you.
Great to be with you. Yep.
Trish and Violet, thank you so very much.